一杯咖啡吸收宇宙能量。 Hello and welcome to A Coffee with Ren. I'm Tian Wei. They say a good conversation could be just like drinking a cup of black coffee, as stimulating and probably as hard. Well, I'm not sure whether today's conversation is going to be a really difficult one, but certainly stimulating intellectually and thought-provoking if you take a look at the panelists on the stage. They are trailblazers in their respective fields and certainly very outspoken about the challenges that we are facing today. I hope it's a conversation among minds without borders. First up, a coffee with Ren, so let's start with Ren. Ren Zhengfei, founder and CEO of Huawei. Of course, a legendary entrepreneur from China who has made China one of the leaders of 5G in the world. Huawei now, as far as I understand, is the largest manufacturer of telecommunication equipment and the second largest maker of smartphones. So Mr. Ren, welcome. On his right, Nicholas Negroponte. The reason why I introduced Mr. Negroponte the second place is because he has just accepted Mr. Ren as his student. Big news. A tech visionary and the co-founder together with Jeremy Weisner of the MIT Media Lab. Certainly, he's been providing funding for startup companies around the world, including Wired Magazine and Sohu, and he has also decided to devote the remainder of his time, which is a lot, to open science and global connectivity. Good to see you, sir. Nicholas. Next, we have George Gilder, a fun person, certainly, a tech guru and a futurist, according to many. George has been the most quoted living author by Ronald Reagan and certainly has been a venture capitalist in the US and Israel on many important projects. He enjoys his moment as a runner and also as a skier. George, good to see you.
Great to be here.
Last but certainly not least, we have a wonderful lady sitting on the stage as well. Longtime commitment to Huawei, 25 years working for this company, and a colleague of Mr. Ren, Ms. Catherine Chen, Senior Vice President and Director of the Board of Huawei. Welcome. Okay, so a coffee with Ren, I really need to start with Mr. Ren. Ren 先生, 是不是不能去美国了?
Mr. Ren.
所以把好朋友都叫到中国来喝咖啡了。
Is it because you cannot go to the US?
So you can't go to the US anymore, that's why you bring all your friends to China? For coffee?
尼古拉斯先生呢, 是乔布斯的老师,
Professor Nicholas, 他的儿子给乔布斯同一个学校。我今天拜他为老师，说我跟乔布斯就是同学了。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光荣。我感到无上的光
我读了那个驾驶维刚那个序言，英文版的驾驶维刚那个序言，写的非常好，我非常崇拜他。啊，对。
It didn't translate.
It translates, okay. Yes, a lot of respect for you because you write a preface for an important book that he values, really.
Okay.
And he has a lot of respect as a result. And it's good to see you and also meet you intellectually.
Thank you.
Mm. Okay.
Well, I first want to protest. This is not coffee.
So they got you tea over here.
Tea, yeah. Oh.
But didn't you say you have too many coffee today already? Okay. But I want to turn the table to both of you here. Aren't you being afraid of being politically incorrect? coming to China and sitting here in the sitting room of Huawei while knowing what's going on between U.S. and China?
No. No, I think that I can contribute to saving the United States in this from a terrible mistake that it's currently making, epitomized by their stupid bans and tariffs and restrictions on Huawei. But also, I can contribute to a reconstruction of internet architecture to address the terrible security collapse across the internet that makes everybody paranoid and nobody trusts anybody else. And it's really a technical problem that Huawei can address, not a political problem.
Are we facing a technical problem or a political problem, Nicholas?
I am more of the feeling that we're facing a cultural problem. And I'm here for a different reason. And I invited myself to come here and even told Mr. Ren what day I could come. And it was surprising that George, whom I've known for 40 years, was here on the same day. So I'm very pleased.
And who do not agree with you on any of the
we
subjects?
Don't tend, we don't agree on political issues.
What, don't we what do we disagree on?
Oh, George. At any rate, but we agree on the fact that the United States is making a terrible mistake. First of all, picking on a company. I was on the Motorola board of directors for 15 years. One of the first joint ventures you did was probably with Motorola. I suspect it was. Mm-hmm. And my interest is open information, open science. I come from a world where what we value isn't so much trade and commerce and stock values. We value knowledge. And we want to build on the people before. And the only way this works is if people are open at the beginning and we can all build on each other. And that's, to me, the priority. There are other issues, and I'm not denying them, but that's the one I'm focused on. Mm. How does the world collaborate? It's not a competitive world in the early stages of science. It benefits from collaboration.
有人说是技术问题，有人说是文化问题，您认为是什么问题呢？还是没有问题，或者不大了？嗯，我觉得人类社会的最主要的目的是要创造财富，是更多的人来摆脱贫穷。那社会呢，一定是要是合作共赢的，每个国家孤立起来发展，这是在信息社会时候可能的，对吧？ 在工业社会的时候，是有一这个交通问题、运输问题，形成了地缘政治和地缘的经济。一个国家可以单独做一个缝纫机、做一个拖拉机、做一个什么这个东西，在信息社会，一个国家单独做成一个东西是没有现实可能性的。 国际上一定是走向开放合作，只有开放合作，才能赶上人类文明的需求，才能使更低的成本让更多人享受到新的技术带来的这个福祉。所以说，我认为呢，从根本的性的问题来说呢，我认为人类社会还是要走向一种共同的合作发展，才是一条真正的道路。 经济走向全球化，应该是西方先提出来的。我们认为这个口号是非常正确的，但是在全球化的过程中会有波澜。这个波澜出现以后，我们是要去正确对待，是要用一种法理、各种规则来去调节、去解决，而不是。 采取一种极端的方法，人类的文明呢，往往是科学家有了发现，政治家有了强烈的领导。
然后企业家有了一定的创造，全人类共同努力形成了新的财富。大家也知道，欧洲也经历了中世纪的黑暗，没有吃的。中国在四五十年前也是很贫穷的，是没有吃的，对吧？那今天来说都吃不完了。其实天还是那个天，地还是那个地，所有环境都会变化。为什么现在富裕了？就是科学技术的进步给人类带来了新的幸
福。I think Mr. Ren, you sound very philosophical, 听上去非常哲学化啊。但是我问你一个具体的问题。
Allow me to
I'm going to ask you a very
specific
question, that is, what are you going to do with those American companies who do not provide Huawei anymore components and parts, despite of the fact you had contracts before? 我要问您呢，如果那些美国公司现在不给你们华为提供原材料了，或者是相关的零配件了，那您以后还要跟他们来往吗？
第一点呢，这个美国公司他们是富有道德良心的，他们这些公司是非常好的，因为我们过去的三十年的发展没有离开世界上所有先进发达的公司对我们的支持与帮助，对吧？所以我们现在这受到一些挫折呢，不是发自他们的本心，而是发自一些这个政治家对事物的认识的不同看法。我们公司呢也曾经预测到，我们公司发展到很快很高的时候，我们会有市场上的竞争，会有矛盾，会有一些东西。但是没有想到美国打击我们华为的战略决心如此之大，如此之坚定不移。同时我们也没有想到美国在战于打击我们的面如此之宽广，对不对？不仅是打击零部件不能供应我们，我们不能参加很多国际组织，我们不能给大学去加强合作，我们不能去使用美国成分的任何东西，我们甚至不能给美国有这些成分的网络去连接，对吧？所以我们要做公有云的情况下，有可能慢慢会变成私有云，对吧？那么但是呢，我们认为这些东西呢是阻挠不了我们的这个前进的步伐的，对吧？我们这个，但是我们先前的想法没有预测到有这么严重，我们是做了一些准备，就像我们那架烂飞机一样，对不对？我们只保护了心脏，只保护了油箱，没有保护其他次要的部件。说我们未来这两年公司会减产的，我们估计会下降$300亿，这样子在今年或明年你销售收入都会在$1000亿左右。2021年我们可以重新焕发出勃勃新生机，重新为人类社会提供服务。因为这两年我们要进行很多版本的切换，这么多版本要切换是需要一个时间，而且需要一个磨合，需要一个时间的检验，对吧？当我们走完这一步以后，我们已经变得更坚强了。那我们以前不坚强的时候，我们都要加强跟美国公司合作。那我们更坚强以后，为啥不跟美国公司合作呢？我更不害怕使用美国的零部件，也不害怕使用美国的要素，也不害怕跟美国的任何这个零合作。但是也可能有一些公司没有我们这么强大，可能就很谨慎地使用美国的要素，使用美国的这个成分，这样的话对美国经济会造成一定的伤害，对吧？但是我们不会，因为我们已经很坚强了，我们是打不死的鸟，对不对？
是吧？Miss Chen, did Miss Ren?Tell everybody in the company about that, the plan for 2021. 任先生有没有告诉咱们华为所有员工关于2021年这个计划？ 可能偶尔的时候会谈起来，但是数字也不一定完全都一样。太有意思了，华为这个文化呀，人工之间呀是非常融洽和有意思的。我这次到你们这里来工作，发现了这个特点。Okay, so what about that? It seems that Mr. Ren gave us a lot of information earlier about the bottom line he's thinking about, George.
Well, I think it's absolutely important that all these new ventures be founded on a level of a ground state of security, which on which these innovations can depend, and which make them trustworthy, recognizably trustworthy around the world. Because a worldwide network or a worldwide Internet of Things or a worldwide 3D virtual reality internet, all these various goals, smart cities, all depend on a secure ground state of time-stamped factuality.
We understand that. Security. But right. How? That is the issue.
How?
And what
blockchain.
About the standards?
Blockchain. Have you heard of it?
Yes, it's I heard it from your new
it's
book.
It's an innovation. And it is what the new generation of technologists around the world are working on and developing. And I think it should be incorporated in this Huawei plan for the future.
But what about standards? Since we talk about security, since we talk about some specific issues, Mr. Negroponte, what about these issues from your perspective, starting earlier days, thinking already of what's going to happen today? What about standards? Do we have global standards? And how fast can we build the global standard? Do we want to build a global standard?
Well, first of all, I've been doing this so long that when I was first on the internet, I knew everybody else on it. That's how long ago it was. And nobody imagined how it would grow. And if they tell you now they're being revisionists, it was not in any way imagined to be this dominant. And I experienced over my life, first as a teenager, I experienced Sputnik. It's very interesting because Sputnik caused the United States to do things that it wasn't already doing. So this is your Sputnik moment. What the United States has done created Huawei's Sputnik, and you are going to wake up and do things, and there's no going back. I saw it again in the 1980s with Japan, terrified by Japan. And there was a whole period when Japan was this enemy, and we were not supposed to collaborate, and yet that sort of attenuated. So now we're going through a Japan moment in China. And I hope that plays itself out. Standards are important, but not as important as they used to be, partly because you have enough intelligence in the system that you don't have to necessarily have a precise standard that everybody's following, as long as the systems can recognize what it is and say, oh, that's that signal, and adapt itself. So there is a change, but there's importance to collaborate on sort of, let me call it the basis of knowledge, because if we start going in other directions separately, it's going to be an enormous shame, and we should shame in all senses of the word.
Talking about basis of knowledge, I really need to ask Mr. Ren. Because right now, Huawei's collaboration with quite a number of American universities and labs have been halted, including some of those where you were originally coming from. And that is not going to contribute to the open science as we speak. But to Mr. Ren, though, it's also going to have a big impact on where Huawei could be in terms of your capacity for science and technology.
首先人类的这个社会的创造呢，这分成理论的创造和市场需求的创造。中国呢，在工程的创造能力上是强的，在理论的创造还是弱的，对吧？我们在基础理论的研究上，还是认真想西方学习。 对吧？西方经历了几百年，比如说微积分的发明啊，比如很多基础原理的发明啊，我认为这一点来说，西方做了很大贡献。华为公司虽然每年投入巨额的基金。 虽然我们有八万多创造这个人员，那我首先移动通信不是华为发明的，光纤的通信不是华为发明的，这个移动互联网不是发明的，只是这些东西我们做的最好，飞机也不是我们发明的，汽车也不是我们发明的，马车也不是我们发明的，所以我们其实我们公司在这个。 社会发明上对人类的贡献还是小的，我们聚焦是在工程能力上起到了作用。我们现在呢，对300多所大学、900多个科研机构外部的给予了支持。我们也力图将来在理论创新上能不能做一些贡献？那现在我们还没有，对吧？但是我们并不因为。 受到一定的打击，我们就萎缩了，就咽气了，不会。我们继续努力。美国大学不跟我们合作，还有很多大学跟我们合作。其实美国还有很多大学也是跟我们在合作的，对吧？只是一两所大学，他们可能有点看法是可以理解的，这是个短时间的行为，是因为他们不了解我们。如果美国更多的这个政治家到我们公司来看。 看看，他看看，想象，在他的想象，可能我们是一个茅草棚啊，我们还打着个大垫子啊，对不对？你们一个大垫子，一个茅草棚，你们就跑我们这个乱闯我们的这些牛乱闯我们东西。如果他来看看我们的延时性的创新的跟随的步伐。 他会觉得我们应该也是好朋友，应该是可以，是可信的。刚才乔治教授讲了，将来要打下一个可信的网络，我们是下的决心。当然，我这个决心是。 过去的商业计划中做出决心，我们将投5000亿美金，对网络这个架构进行重构，从而使它变得更简单、更快捷、更可信，对吧？至少要达到欧洲的 GDPR 的这个标准，对吧？至少要达到这样。那现在如果说我们的财务受到一定打击呢？ 我们想，我们这个科研的投入不会减少，基本上也接近这个数字，接近数字。 来完成对我们自己的改造，给人类贡献，对吧？因为你想一想，在非洲那个非极端贫穷的地方，在罗辑埃博拉病、艾滋病流行的地方，在那个荒野上，都是华为人在奋斗。我们能赚啥钱？那赚不了多少钱。我们还是为了人类理想在奋斗，对吧？所以因此，我们认为说，我们在。 这个理论发明上没做出贡献，那对人类服务上，我们应该多做一点贡献，来弥补我们在理论上还没有发明吧。
Contributing to the humanity, that's a great thing. Also have good market, that's a good thing too, I guess. To you, Mr. Gilder, talking about security earlier, Mr. Ren has mentioned about that. So there are a lot of questions whether Huawei has backdoors. 一会儿我们请任先生也来回应一下。Of course, Mr. Ren will respond to that. But to you, whose security is it? Who will guarantee the security? Who are the ones to judge whether one system or another system has security or not?
Well, the question is an objective question, whether a specific telecom system can be tested, whether it is open, whether it can afford to be using the new cryptographic techniques, cryptographic signing of software that can render it inherently trustworthy because it can't be changed gratuitously. There are lots of technical remedies for the kinds of distrust that arises around this catastrophically insecure internet architecture that we find ourselves using today. Just as we have a catastrophically broken monetary system, we got a which causes trade wars, we also have a catastrophically broken internet security system. Mm. And I think Huawei can contribute among all the companies in the world, Huawei is probably best situated to solve both these problems or to pursue both these, that single opportunity.
Is Mr. Gilder having too much hope for Huawei? Is he being too optimistic or pessimistic?
Well, I hope he's correct. And there's some evidence that he may be, because our president has already said publicly that he would reconsider Huawei if we can make a trade deal. So clearly it's not about national security. We don't trade national security. So it's about something else. And this trade war has got to end. And that, I believe, will end sooner rather than later. Crossing my fingers.
Knock the wood. However, Mr. Ren, I have to ask you. You need to respond to that too. 任先生，我们但是也要问您这个问题：到底华为有没有做了很多后门？有没有这个安全的问题？你是要对我们的好朋友们，也对看我们今天这个整体的直播的朋友们，全世界的朋友们讲一讲。我认为第一点呢。
把网络安全和信息安全作为两个问题要分离开来说，因为网络安全就是整个这个担负人类社会廉洁这个网络是不能随意瘫痪的，不能随意出现故障的。因为出现这样的话，就这是一个安全问题，对吧？大家知道，65亿人要连接起来，而且数千万家银行要连接起来，数万万家这个中小企业、大企业要连接起来，银行的转账在65亿中随便跳要，一定要转到这个人的账上，而且不能少一分钱。 否则的话，这个网络是有问题的。这个我们公司呢，已经担负为人类30亿人口进行连接，包括银行给每个人的转账啊，所有的东西，对吧？就是连接。30年在一百70个国家证明，我们网络是安全的，没有怎么瘫痪过，对吧？这个网络是安全的。 那个信息安全呢？我们提供是一个管道，还有一个水龙头，把我们的终端比成水龙头，把我们的这个连接网比成管道的话，里面流水还是流油，这是不是我们管道公司的责任？这是运营商和内容提供商的责任，对吧？但我们公司有没有后门呢？就是肯100%没有后门的。我们呢愿意给全世界的国家签订。 无后门的协定，对吧？后门协定，但是为什么签订不了呢？是因为这些国家提出来，要所有的网络设备供应商、所有的网络商都要来签订这个没有后门的协定，说它通过了难度大。 但是为什么不先给我签呢？就有个榜样，然后拿着我的这个范本去给别人谈呢？很多国家的总统我都谈过，对吧？但是他们也在讨论过这个问题。他什么时候签我呢？我们总要在一个国家签订了这个条约以后，就把这个范本给大家看。你看，我还是敢签我的，保证是没有后门的，对吧？是敢于做承担这个责任，对吧？ 但是呢，我们这次我讲前面讲的话，但是后面我再讲一个话呢，就安全与不安全是相对的。
security and insecurity.
因为我们将来这个我们大气层这个厚度呢是1000公里， 但是我们以信息云组成这个云层的厚度呢，可能不止几千公里。这么厚的云层中总会出现这样或那样的差错，说不定雷打错了，雷该在这边打，他没有打，打到另外地方去了。那这个时候应该怎么追究呢？应该救错误。 追究错误，有救错误，解决错误，救错误，处分错误，不能无缘无故的就对一个公司随意就随便一直打击，你这样子没有法治国家一定要遵守以法律为基准的，法没有未经审判你怎么就？ 判决了呢，对吧？说这个问题是现在来说，将来还会发生这样的问题，因为云社会越来越复杂，越来越入口越来越多，越来越容易失控。如果大家都谨慎到一个插手不能出，这社会就保守了，而不是一种开放，不是一种竞争，不是一种创造的社会。陈女士
，Miss Chen， 刚才我问严先生到底哪个国家呀？他不说。
但我知道呢，他在你们内部一直说爱美国嘛，因为事情发生了很多变化。但是呢，我们认为呢，美国呢是一个先进发达的国家，对不对？大家知道200多年前是印第安人，是一个很荒凉的地方，对吧？ 清教徒登陆以后，把英国的一些制度、法律带过去以后，是英美国在有序的情况下加强开发，是吧？这样美国成为世界上最强大的国家。那这些好多都是我们这要学习的。我们在少量问题的挫折，我们也不能恨一个美国，对吧？美国是一个很漫长的历史，这个小小短短除了插座，我们就记恨一辈子，那我们只有落后。我们只
Mr. Negroponte, interesting what Mr. Ren just said. He seems to have, he wants to look at the long stretch of history rather than concentrating on one specific point of time. So exactly what can we learn from history? I mean, you already also talk about history, whether it's Japan or about the moment. What can we really learn? They say it's the rule of the jungle anyway.
Well, we can learn by looking at various technologies that were quite invented in the United States and then went elsewhere because we didn't have the industrial commercial courage and ability to develop them because they took long term. I'll give you two examples. One example is flat panel displays. I had a piece of glass in my laboratory in the early 1970s. It was the beginning of flat panel displays. The United States couldn't bring it forward. It took too much investment, and so it went to Japan and then later other places. The same thing happened with, even before that, videotapes. There was a big commotion when people invented videotapes, and then off they went. We didn't develop. Same things happened with telecommunications. Government funding in my lab stopped 20 years ago, and interest in the telecommunications development went elsewhere. It's not in the United States, so let's say it's in Europe, it's at Ericsson, it's at Nokia, it's at Huawei. It's not really in the United States anymore. So history has shown that the short term, usually quarter to quarter, view of American industry precludes some of these big long-term developments. And Huawei looks beyond that and has been able to develop things in 5G and other areas that couldn't happen in the way we're set up. It didn't lend itself to small entrepreneurship, and it doesn't lend itself to big American corporations the way they're currently shaped.
Mr. Gilder. Many say, wow, probably we are already at the very beginning of a technological Cold War anyway. We're going to have decouple between China and the United States or between China and some of the other countries technology-wise. Are you as easygoing about the reality as Mr. Ren, and also as historical as Mr. Negroponte?
Well, I think Mr. Ren is right to be complacent. I mean, he's in the strong position. He has the 56,000 patents. He has the, this 80,000 R&D employees. He's focused on the technologies of the future. It's the United States that really will suffer from any effort to decouple.
Are you doing American bashing right now?
I'm an American, and I believe that we have wonderful entrepreneurial energies, wonderful creativity, and wonderful technology. But it's always thrived in collaboration with other countries. When we were an underdeveloped economy, Ford, Edison, Carnegie, all our great entrepreneurs that established the oil, automobile, electrical industries stole from Europe. That was, everybody said they stole from Europe, that they sent spies into European companies and brought back crucial insights that made possible the Ford automobile. It's what we see here from historic terms is merely the incumbent established technology power of the United States challenged by an ascendant challenger, China, and we are trying to beat them back. And that's a terrible suicidal mistake for the United States to make. So I'm being pro-American when I say America's got to deal with Huawei and with the existence of challengers around the world. We're not in the lead in semiconductors anymore. This idea that we have some impregnable lead in semiconductors that we can use to negotiate, force China into compliance with some requirements that we imagine, is wrong. We don't lead in semiconductors. Taiwan leads us in semiconductors. Apple's new CPU had to be made in Taiwan. 7-nanometer geometries were not feasible at Intel anymore. I mean, it's just false that the United States is in an impregnable position. It doesn't have to collaborate with China and other countries around the world. It's an illusion from years gone by, and we've got to get over it if we're going to accept the challenges of the future and accomplish the goals we have.
But with the elections, okay. After that, Mr. Chen, too. Okay.
总体来说呢, 美国的科学技术呢是比中国先进和发达的，中国比技术以后发展，中国是在开放改革的30多年了，有了这么一个科技，100多年的发展，你两倍，你近步，对吧？如果上游的水不流了，下游来，下游就干枯了。我们中国也发展也会困难。但是如果上游没有下游，它的也会枯竭，因为下游的市场对它的作用也是很大的，它也会缓慢。所以刚才科技脱钩，切开，这个不好服历史发展的规律，对吧？ 第二个，人类社会呢，不是丛林发展，因为人类社会总的是要合作共赢的，对吧？因为多种力量是制衡的，就是市场经济。为什么要做市场经济？不走计划经济，做市场经济，你看制衡来制衡去，制衡就是重复建设，就有浪费。但是这个制衡是让它有序的在发展，做市场经济是在制衡的，说不可能是完全是丛林发展，谁？ 狮子就把我们兔子全吃光了。我估计如果几万只兔子去咬一只狮子呢，狮子吃满肚子了，它就吃不动了，那个兔子可能有一个根一浩大的毛呢，对吧？所以因此我认为呢，就是说不是丛林法则，对吧？因为我们在这个社会上还有法律，还有制度，还有宗教，还有道德的约束，这些约束都使得我们这个社会不走向丛林法则，对吧？特别社会还有反垄断法，你当你这个狮子撞到一定程度，就不准你壮大了。必须两刀子劈成两个狮子，对吧？让你自己内部富养也竞争，那维保持社会的这个平衡和发展。华为公司也不会在五 G 领域里面偶然有点点领先，然后就得意忘形，不会的。我们还是和社会开放共享，开放共享的，对吧？所以我们认为呢，这一点来说呢，就第一点，这个世界实行科技脱钩的方法，两家都是受害，不会哪一家是赢家。
听明白了，这个林子挺大，除了林子还有狮子和兔子啊。Ms. Chen, so it seems that Huawei has already long decided that you can not only survive, but also thrive after this round of crisis. 听起来好像华为已经早想明白了。活下来，然后活得更好。
我其实也挺不喜欢用丛林法则来形容我们人类社会，因为大家都知道最凶猛的动物狮子老虎没有人能打得过，但是为什么人类社会发展到今天是团结，是协作，是合作，所以我觉得这个是永恒的道理，而不是丛林法则。讲华为的话，我觉得可能现在大家都特别关心，就是说华为有很大的困难和压力，其实我在这25年我不觉得今天是一个最大的困难和压力，对不对？因为你要回想，我觉得任先生他创业的时候一定是最困难的，因为啥也没有，那时候没技术，没钱，没人，就几个人开始哈。我印象中就郭平先生嘛，那时候是不是比我来得早加入的华为哈？那时候什么都没有，都可以有今天。我觉得今天的挑战和压力应该，我觉得不算什么。我觉得我们所有的事情，华为这30年来就是面对困难，面对问题，面对挑战，然后去解决它。
好 ，if things are not as challenging as all of you illustrated. I feel so happy as a journalist. But now, here's another thing. We could not only just concentrate our conversation on Huawei and the current specific point of challenge, but rather where we're going from here, every one of us. Mr. Ren has been very passionate about 5G. That's certainly going to build the infrastructure in the world to empower communication and many others. Mr. Gilder has been, over the years, arguing about that artificial intelligence is not going to replace human being, but human capacity and also human brain is enormous. Meanwhile, Mr. Negroponte, you have been arguing in many of your speeches and books about the biotech is the new digital, as you have written a book, Being Digital, back in the 1990s.
It's the
everybody
old
read
digital.
It. Yeah, well, and you argue even that we can probably eat a pill from now on and learn Chinese, not through the eyes, but through within the body. So what kind of future?
You don't really say that.
Yes, I do.
Yes, he did. He talked about French, learning
French. I say
French.
It. What? That doesn't mean it's true.
It certainly isn't no. true. So I'm glad that.
But it could be.
No, it couldn't be.
Yes, it, well.
No, ideas are not material. That's just a fundamental misconception. That.
Nor are pills, once they get into your bloodstream.
Yeah. So, let me ask one by one if we can. And Crossfire is also welcomed here on this stage. About where are we talking about, and what would you concentrate about the bigger trend? Let's start from what many call a futurist. Mr. Gilder?
I believe that the basic challenge of the world economy today is to address the scandal of money. We today have $5.1 trillion every 24 hours of currency trading. And this currency trading accomplishes nothing except to endow central banks with the right to steal from the future in order to consume in the present, and steal from future generations. And I believe that the real reason for the trade war is not trade or industrial machinations. It's the collapse of money. So $5.1 trillion a day of currency trading is 25 times all global GDP. It's 75 times all trade in goods and services. And it doesn't even prevent constant hedging of every transaction across a border. It doesn't prevent trade conflicts. It doesn't really accomplish its goal.
Okay.
And so I think that the great contribution of blockchains is to allow a new global currency that plays the role that gold played for hundreds of years of the fastest growth of the world economy. And that's really what blockchain, not only a new internet architecture, but also a new global architecture for the world economy.
And you don't think that's virtual wealth only, just like the stock brokers?
It's not wealth itself. It's the measuring stick of wealth that guides entrepreneurial visions and creativity. You got to have a measuring stick, just as you need to measure the second, the kilogram, the ampere, the mole, all the various measuring sticks that make it possible to make a chip in Taiwan and incorporate it in a smartphone in Shenzhen and send it to Cupertino for marketing and to Israel for amplification. And all that is made possible by common measuring sticks. The nanometer is the same in Shenzhen as it is in Timbuktu. Mm. But money, which is a critical measuring stick, is different all around the world. It's being manipulated by national central banks. And so we have a chaos of money. And that's why the world economy is slowing down now, is why trade is no longer growing, why countries are constantly fragmenting and fighting over valuations. Mm. And I think this is the big opportunity. I think Huawei can play a key role in surmounting this challenge.
We'll let Mr. Ren to respond a bit later. But for you, Mr. Negroponte, of course you disagree with your friend.
No, I don't disagree with that because I don't know enough about that. And it's fascinating to listen to. I would take, because I believe the question was, what are some of the big future trends? And I think they all surround one aspect of the scientific and technical world that has changed in the past 30 years. And that is that we can make things and design things and build things that are so small and get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller that there's been a crossover point with nature. And when I grew up, the natural world and the artificial world were very different. In fact, I was trained as an architect, and good architecture is the architecture that fits well with the natural world. But now the natural world and the artificial world are the same. Hmm. And they're the same in ways that are very surprising. When I founded the Media Lab, I never imagined we would have a team, as we have today, who design mice. And they design new mice. And are the mice real or are they artificial? They're manufactured, and they're walking, living mice. And so there's certain things that you think about. For example, 10 years from now, maybe Huawei will ship base stations as seeds that you plant, and you water it, and it grows. And guess what? It grows into a base station. And it's powered by the sun and the leaves and it sort of generates, and all of a sudden you have base stations in the middle of nowhere. 10 years from now, that's perfectly plausible. So I think the changes, the reason I say biotech is the new digital, more because of synthetic biology and the fact they'd be indistinguishable. Mm. So I look in that area.
And the world of the digital is also in combination with the world of biotech.
Very much the same.
Yeah. 任先生很开心，觉得种子长的这件事情可以谈论一下，可以讨论一下。You seem to be happy about that idea. What about your future? What do you think?
尼古拉斯所讲的呢，就是 DNA
给电子技术结合以后，
对人类社会会发生一个天文地的变化。对这个问题，我没有研究，所以我没有发言权。但是我觉得人类社会未来二三十年最伟大的这个。这个推动力量应该是人工智能，因为这个社会变得越来越复杂，火车跑得越来越快，对不对？那么这个包括网络越来越复杂，这个也是单体个人你治理不能驾驭的，对吧？那么将来有些确定性的工作。人工智能就拦截了，就不要再往上传了。这些不能确定性的工作往上传呢，到中央处理的时候呢，再通过人工智能来分析。那人工智能可能处理错，也可以处理对，处理错、处理对都是在深度学习，为完善人类的社会。刚才我说要宽容创新，不要这个吹毛求疵。网络上不得了得很，对不对？维修一下网，肯定可能远程维护。这么远程维护就变成什么？东西要来，那人类就一定要爬到电杆上去维护，难道是正确的吗？那是高成本，对吧？所以因此对未来的创新啊，要有种宽容心态，我们才能迎接未来伟大的这个社会。不要把人工智能呢看成一个负面东西，对吧？人工智能是人的能力的延伸。刚才就说吃个药片就把《红楼梦》读完了。再吃一个药片，莎士比亚读完了；再吃一个药片，人类社会几百种语言全学会了。
同时服用四种以上药物。
我觉得这个人的脑袋容量就那么大，但是如果用电子的容量来说呢，可是无限大的。说人工智能的出现是在超级计算机和这个高速的传送的条件下。才能产生的，他是尽管这个尼古拉斯教授说几十年前就有人提出，但是他没有实现手段，今天是有实现手段的，实现这个手段只能给人类创造更大的财富，不会对人类创造，因为他不是作为替代人。刚才有人说，就是他怎么人工智能怎么理解这个会线，对不对？怎么去听音乐，对吧？欣赏音乐。就不是说啊，这个歌你听了、啊，那不是，就是为什么有顶级的音乐家？那这个人工智能是不是能出现顶级音乐家这一点，我现在还持问号。
OK， 我看出来了，这个老师和学生还是有默契的啊，虽然是刚拜的师啊。You have certain common ground between the so-called teacher and the student, Mr. Gilder. It seems that they are disagreeing to a certain extent with what you just said.
Well,
我可不是挑事儿啊
I've been studying connectome studies for a while. And the connectome, for years I studied the connectome of the internet. That is, how large are all the connections all across the entire global internet and connections to all its memories. And I was always...focusing on the point where the connectome of the global internet would pass a zettabyte. That is, all the memories and all the connections would take a zettabyte, 10 to the 21, to map. And recently I've been studying the connectome of the human brain, one human brain. And...The connectome of the human, one human brain takes an entire zettabyte. In other words, one human brain has as much connectivity as the entire global internet. Yet the entire global internet consumes gigawatts, terawatts of energy. One human brain runs on 12 to 14 watts of energy. So I believe that what really will determine human progress and prosperity is unleashing individual human zettabytes running at 12 watts, that's 6 billion of them that you're interconnecting through the Huawei fiber optics and wireless, not creating some super mouse out of a pill. I mean, the life is not the same as electronics.
Okay.
It manifests electronics, but it's a different phenomenon which is not well understood and is not illuminated by facile statements that we're going to be able to read Shakespeare by taking a pill. That just is not illuminating.
Mr. Negroponte, I think it's perfect time for you to speak out.
Look, whatever is true in computation and connectivity, I can make more of it. You can make more and more of it. Yeah. And some of that's going to happen naturally.
More.
So a lot of people have worked, and there are really two kinds, very two distinct AIs. There's the AI, if you will, that wants to do as well or better than the human brain. That's the one that is, I'll call, the classic one. It's the one that the people in the 1960s and 70s, very deep thinkers, were thinking about. It was not an AI composed of 7.5 billion people. I don't know what you guys are doing with the other 1.5, by the way, when you talk about connecting everybody. Yeah. But when you have the 7.5 billion brains connected, you have something times 7.5 billion. And that's a different area and a fascinating one. And whatever happens computationally, I just know I can make more of it. I can't make more of the human brains, and ours aren't going to change that much. So things will change, George. And I think, you know, when I say you learn French by taking a pill or Chinese, that is part of a very different agenda of how do you interact with the human brain. And the breakthrough was the idea of going from the inside instead of the outside, instead of trying to radiate. What if you went through the bloodstream, and what if you were able to access all the neurons from that direction? That's pretty interesting. And I don't know where French lives. Does it live in a part of your brain? Probably not, but the process to speak French certainly does. Can you put that there? Can you take it away? It doesn't matter whether that is correct or not right now. It's certainly a very exciting way of thinking about it, and people will do things and change things as a consequence taking that kind of step.
Pill or not pill, that is not the question.
Right.
The really question is, what are we going to see in the future? So let's talk about the future also a little bit more. For example, lifelong learning, Mr. Ren, 终生学习, certainly is going to be extremely important for everyone, no matter what kind of future we are talking about. So to all of you, how does that happen? What is the best tool? What is your way of lifelong learning? I'm sure you have to learn very fast, particularly recently.
但是不管你学得这么快，你不如机器快。
No matter how fast you are, you are not as fast as machines. No matter how long you commit yourself to learning, your life is always limited. So we think that AI can inherit
the civil
thinking of people of civilization.
The way of thinking of Einstein 用这个模型都可以用啊，技术齐全，所以我认为它会给人类创造极大的未来的机会。但这个机会是啥样子呢？我描写不出来。就像我年轻时候，当小孩的时候，我不可能想象北京有这么多汽车马路，因为我们58年。就是老师放假一天，为什么到马路上去看汽车，看解放牌过路？我们怎么知道世界还有那么多汽车呢？那今天我们就知道堵车是我们过节最大的特点，对吧？所以因此我们今天也不能预测未来人类社会怎么样，但是我认为这个终身学习是对一个人的激励，但是对一个社会的学习就是要无生命的迭代，就是无生命的迭代。这种迭代通过机器的学习，对算法的理解，不断的复盘，不断的建模，不断的复盘，不断的建模，人类社会终有一天会对很多复杂的问题用简单的方法理解。就是并不是，就是很复杂的事情，今天我们要很多人做，将来可能就是很少人就做了，对吧？所以因此我认为这个终身学习的问题不要停留在一个人生命中的各终身学习，要广泛认识一个社会的终身学习，而且要跨国界跨领域的，对吧？在我们这一代人呢，我们还有地缘政治的概念，因为我们小时候就没有出过家门，不要说出国门，那个县门都没有出过，对不对？都要长了好大了才从县里面离开过，所以你有地域概念。现在的年轻孩子们在互联网这个领域中，他已经没有地域概念了，意识形态在这个时代慢慢在新的年轻一代慢慢在淡化，对吧？那新的学习方式是新的学习方式，所以我们面对未来人类社会，我认为是更美好的，不是更恐怖的。大家从情感上能理解人工智能代替人类的时候，那是恐怖现象，那是文学家想象的。但是社会有法理，有宗教，有道德，有共同的这个自由措施，是非人类的不正确现象，让它不能发生，会发生少一点，对吧？我们认为财富会越创造越多，不是越来越少，对吧？大家也知道说，中国人现在富起来了，大家都吃鱼了，对吧？但是从谷歌的这个地图上来看呢，中国沿海都是网箱，大多鱼还是人工喂养的，所以因此它并没有完全大量的以消耗自然资源为中心，就这就是劳动力生产力的解放而创造新的产品，对吧？当然我提倡这个社会要走向节俭社会，不能怎么铺张浪费。你想挪威这个国家很富裕，但我对挪威最大的印象是什么呢？人人都住小房子，人人都开很小的汽车，我们代表说买不起汽车，说我去了都是坐火车，对吧？说明就是说你看一个富裕的国家也可以形成一种节俭的方式，那我们社会形成一种节俭的方式，是生活是富裕的，但是是节俭的。那我认为人类的资源消耗不会想象那么大，但是创造资源的能力是在增强。所以我认为不会出现战争的。
您不仅讲到是终生学习了，更是我们的世界如何更好的自身完美不断向前发展。Can I have Ms. Chen first before I go to you? I'll have Ms. Chen first. Okay, I'll come back to you. 刚才啊，
三位老师看的特别的长哈，一看就看到30年以后去了。我肯定没有这个能力，我就看3年5年。我现在最大的期盼就是，我觉得技术是让我们生活更美好。我最大的期待就是华为、爱立信、Nokia、China Mobile 啊、沃达丰啊，我们一起快点把5G 建好。这样的话呢，就是前两天我儿子是去美国看 NBA， 他支持勇士队，我是支持加拿大多伦多的那个猛龙队的。那5G 技术建好之后，我觉得我在中国，他在美国，我们也可以互动得很好，看得很美好。
By the way, it's the Canadian team that won the NBA. It's an interesting world, isn't it? It's a bigger world than many people imagined. Good job.
But
and
it's,
Mr.
But it's not bigger than a, the universe and Ren's cup of coffee. It's really, we get a sense of his visionary horizons when he discourses on AI. I don't think any other corporate leader in the world could give such a sophisticated and wide-ranging analysis of this absolutely central theme of technological development. And that's why the United States has to come to terms with Huawei. It's a resource for the world. It's not a little combatant figure dealing with back doors and little security.
Mr. Gilder, you really sound quite a fan of Huawei.
Yes.
Mr. Negroponte.
Well, your description is certainly poetic, amongst other things, which is very important. I would like to go back to your original question, which was about lifelong learning. And I would like to just remind people that learning is what you do to yourself, and education is what people do to you. Let me just separate the two. And if you look at the best education in the world, it falls in two very distinct groups. There is the group which is characterized by Finland, Sweden, and Norway, where they do very, very well, but there are no tests, shortest hours per day, shortest days per year, and no competition at all. So the kids do very, very well. And then there is, since I'm in China, let me say the Chinese method, which is drill and practice and test, and you probably kill 50% of your children in the process of doing that. But the ones who survive come out strong. Now, I think the second one is a very bad way to do it. And I think the first one is the one that the world will slowly model itself. It doesn't have much traction. Mm. But as you connect kids, thanks to Huawei, and as you bring this connectivity to very remote places, it's amazing what kids can do. And I will bore you with one experiment we did. We went to two villages in Ethiopia that had no literacy. No adult had ever seen a word, a written word. They hadn't seen one. And we put in the village the number of tablets as there were kids with no human beings and no instructions. And we left. Now, the one exception is an adult went the day before and showed another adult how to put the solar panel outdoors instead of indoors. That was it. Remotely, we could monitor this. Within 2 hours, the kids found the on-off switch, which is pretty hard because there are no on-off switches in their life. Within a week, they were singing ABC songs. Within 2 weeks, they were using 50 apps per day for 7 hours per day. That's how long the battery. 6 months later, they hacked Android. And today they speak, read, and write fluent English. No teacher.
Without the pill.
No pill. Before the pill. And no teacher. What's very important is that you can do a great deal of self-learning. I don't advocate that's the way to do it for everybody, but it's amazing what kids can do, and we underestimate them all the time.
Beautifully
said.
That's
the zettabyte I was talking about.
Finally, you agree on something.
Oh, we agree.
I feel so relieved.
We agree on many
things.
On
most things.
Okay, but there's one thing I also want to ask you about, that is, you know, you talk about the potential beauty of a world in which everybody could work together going through this current bump, but it is happening. And therefore, a lot of people that I've been talking to as a journalist have real concerns whether their children's generation are really going to enjoy the kind of life that you guys have been enjoying over the decades, which is you see your life taking up. Going up, getting better, your life's getting better all the time. But maybe the next generation, some are concerned, are not going to be as beautiful as that. Mr. Negroponte, you've been working with kids a lot. $100 laptop for them to go to the world of digital. What do you think?
Well, let me...
It's actually a question of optimism or a little bit pessimistic.
Right, but in full disclosure, I was born very lucky. My parents were rich, their parents were rich, and their parents were rich. Everybody went to college, everybody traveled. We moved all over the world. I'd gone to 30 countries by the time I was 4 years old. So it was, I didn't think of that as privilege. And none of my brothers went into business. We all went into civil service or academia.
Right.
A couple of them are artists. So our measure wasn't the same measure that you're talking about, because very often we think of measure simply as an economic growth. Mm. But after you have that economic growth, you have a purpose. And you die unhappy if you didn't really have a good purpose, and you look back at your life and you say, oh, what was that all about? Mm. Well, some people don't have that question because they've had a purpose and they're allowed to have it. But if you're struggling the whole time, it's harder. So I think that when I hear that young people won't have the same opportunities, I say to myself, well, you know, I don't think that's necessarily true, because they do have something we didn't have. Didn't matter if you were rich or poor. Mm. There was a belief that you had to work for a certain period of time. And probably hate your work.
Okay.
As a lawyer, as a banker, as a hedge fund. I mean, God, hedge funds, what an empty life that is. And then at the end, you start doing something with the rest of your life. There's sort of something happens. And I think young people have learned that that too can be more integrated. Mm-hmm. And I see many, many more young people who have mixed money and meaning.
Okay.
I think that's the key.
That is the key. No offense, hedge funds around the world.
Well, offense, hedge funds, yeah, actually. Okay. You should be ashamed of yourself if you're in the hedge fund business.
Do support education.
Yeah.
That's very important.
That's important.
Mr. Ren, Ren 先生, 您认为呢? 我们未来的,
what do you think?
这些孩子们, 他们的生活会像您这一代一样, 一直感觉在不断的成长, 不断的变好吗?
但是问题是什么叫幸福，这个是一定要讲清楚的，对吧？
That's a very philosophical question. We have about 2 minutes.
因为为什么呢？人类是一代比一代强，对吧？不要老是带有悲观的观点来看待现代的这个小孩。其实小孩可能他们没有经历像我们这么多磨难， 但是他们学习的速度是非常快的，接受新知识的能力是非常强的。像这个尼古拉斯教授讲的，如果说有很多穷孩子也能受到好的教育，人类创造财富的能力更强，人类摆脱贫困的能力更强，那社会就更加和平和友好，对吧？所以我讲的，对未来应该是寄予希望的，一代代的孩子。 应该是越来越比我们优秀，要不我们倒回5000年去最好，那不是，事实上是5000年以前太落后了，我们今天还是比5000年好，那再过2000年，我们相信他比我们发愁的问题他们全解决了，对吧？陈女士呢？我都同意。都同意。What
about you, Mr. Gilder?
I just think it's a foolish indulgence of rich people to believe that the future will be worse than the past. If you just look at the history of China over the last 50 years, of course every subsequent generation has had vastly more opportunities than the previous generation. All around the world, equality has increased because of poor people becoming rich everywhere. It's just in America with our foolish worship of nature and other peculiar climate cranks and weather bores and other ideas of disaster that we imagine that the future will be worse. But if you live in the world and have some sense of history, you see opportunities opening as wide as Huawei's visions.
Mr. Gilder, I understand you have very different views compared to, for example, Mr. Necropondi about climate change issues. But we'll leave it that to another round of discussion, okay? But for now, let me open the floor, since I've been taking advantage of this conversation on the stage so much. But I know there are a lot smarter minds sitting in the audience, and they have much more fascinating questions than the ones that I just asked. So, but no pressure, by the way. So let me just turn to our audience, who are, I understand, make of, you know, the media people, people coming from the think tanks, friends of Huawei or business partners of Huawei, and those who are interested in the latest development of technology that are sitting in the audience. So any one of you have questions, raise your hand, and our staff gonna bring you the microphone. So why don't I do an equal opportunity, okay? So this gentleman first, yes. And then we go there, okay.
Hello, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
So I have two questions, actually. One is for Mr. Ren, and one is for Professor Negroponte.
And could you promise it's not going to be a 5-minute speech, but rather a question?
Okay.
Okay, great.
Two questions. So my first question is, you know, I've been making videos that that talk about Huawei a little bit and try to get the discussion to be a little bit more fair, especially with American public. And so my question for Mr. Zhen is, will Huawei focus on the relationship with American people or more with the American government, or both, or neither? And which is the most important? And then my question for Professor Negroponte is, we know that that America has a open capitalist system, and we know that China has a capitalist system which is governed by the, by the government. But now we're starting to see that America may be turning away technologies that are the best, right? So what happens in a situation where an entity starts to shun or turn down the best technologies? Thanks.
Thank you. Quickly, 咱们快点给到答案。
我觉得呢，就是我们也关注美国的民众，也关注美国的政府，对吧？因为呢，就是不管哪一个人做出不正确的决定，那只是历史掌握中的一小段，对吧？那美国大多数这个做出的决定是正确的，比如说从第二次世界大战，美国做出的巨大牺牲，对吧？这几十年来对社会这个集体 发展所推动的贡献，推动全球化的这个进行，那这也是美国政府推动的，咱们美国政府也是伟大的，对吧？美国人民呢也是伟大的，因为他们努力工作、努力学习，提供了很多先进的理论和宝贵的财富，也是对我们是个帮助。暂时我们不能去美国，这不要紧。那不等于我之后，或者之后的人，中美两国可能共同在享受8G呢？ 那不是5G了，对吧？也不是6G了，都8G9G，100G呢，对吧？也可能。所以，因此我们最终还是要体现要为美国服务的。好，Mr. Necropunti，8G了已经。哦哟，想得好远啊。Mr.
Necropunti，8G，8G，this G stuff is a little overrated. I think the answer to your question is perhaps best, because whatever is closing off now, we just have to stop that. Okay, so there's no trying to prepare for it, we have to stop it. 27% of MIT students come from Asia. I don't know the exact number, but I'm gonna be willing to guess over 20% come from China.
If you count the Chinese Americans who are born in the United States, but both parents are Chinese, the number goes up perhaps to 30%. So we have enormous numbers. You look at the Media Lab, it's 60% foreign students. So when I look at that and people say, well, wait a minute, you're training our competition. No, we're elevating the whole world. It's so old-fashioned to think that if you have something, I don't. And so you're going to take my thing, and so you have it, and I don't. Unfortunately, President Trump thinks that way. He doesn't think in the way that we can both have it, and it can elevate, and it can go up. And training those foreign students is so, so important. Now, I made a mistake 20 years ago. I thought the internet was going to make people more integrated. I thought it would get rid of countries, and some they would get rid of nationalism. It would get, and what happens now? 20. I look around, and it's gotten worse, not better. So I was wrong. So the only thing I can suggest now is intermarriage. Persuade your kids to marry somebody who's not Chinese, okay? And that will help going forward.
Okay. Well, that's a social issue. We're going to discuss that a little bit later. Okay, let's go to this gentleman over there. Yeah, please. No, I can't hear you.
Hello?
Yes.
Hey, this is guy from Bloomberg News. Question for Ren. Sorry, I'm going to use
Can you raise your voice just a little bit? Sure. Because we're a little bit far. Yeah, thank you.
There's a question to Mr. Ren. You mentioned $30 billion in this year and next compared to Huawei's plan. I want to ask, what's your specific plan for the future? We saw earlier. 海底光缆的部分，未来会不会有更多的业务去去被拆分或去卖掉，还是有您对整个这个怎样这个去缓解公司的压力方面有哪些看法？谢谢。我们未来不会有业务成分的问题，也不会有业务卖掉的问题。那海底光缆呢，这个不是今天想卖掉。
其实我们老早就想卖掉，应该说我们有一部分股份已经卖给这个海缆的员工了，对吧？那今天来说呢，我们就觉得呢，搜索一下，而海缆我们是很成功的，也不受影响，不是因为打击受影响，我们卖掉，是我们觉得我们这个事情跟我们现在的主营行当相关性不大，可能会卖掉一些。那其他也不会有拆分或卖掉这个可能。 但是我们可以搜索，因为我们搜索了一些战线的员工呢，就投入到主战线上去了，尽快把主战线做好，对吧？华为公司不会出现大规模裁员和这个问题，但是业务整合已经早就一直在进行。 对吧？最典型的是两年多前，我们裁掉了微软软件这个部门，这个部门大概1-2万美金，耗资了1-2万美金，但是因为他们没有做出啥事来，我们在2年前果断把它裁掉。我们怕员工有市场波动，我还悄悄给人力资源讲，每个人先涨一等工资，让他们再走。 结果这些人根本就等不到你涨工资，就扑到前线上去了。所以终端之所以走得这么旺盛，终端的营还有营这走得那么厉害，是这些有经验的员工扑到这上面去做出成绩。说前段时间他们提出了2年过去了，我去看望他们的时候，才发现他们工资都被咬着走了。为什么？他们到那个主战场去理工去了，对不对？到主战。 场去升官发财去了，我觉得这个精神很好，应该是我们今天表彰。说他们上次提出来，他们要10,000人走红地毯，我同意。后来说走不下手，3,000人我也同意。后来他们自己给自己做了个奖章，然后我去讲了话，当然那奖章做的不是太好，但是习近平说。 因为你讲的话就给这个奖章赋予了意义，他们就很珍惜，对吧？但是我们珍惜华为公司的员工，但是两年了，我们裁掉了这么一个大部门，社会上一点声音都没有，公司内部也没有声音，他们没有涨到工资我都不知道，等我去看望他们才知道，他们不等涨工资就扑到主战场去了。那今天我们其实很多业务重整啊，已经早就在开始了，已经早就开始了。
All right, thank you. I hope answer your question. And this direction, yeah, this gentleman, then I go to that one. Yes. 来，这边这位先生的，哎。
Thank you. I have a question.
Could you help us to understand who you are, and would you ask the question, please?
Yes, I'm Esteban Buso, a professor at the Harvard Institute of Technology, ancient graduate from MIT, where I met Professor Negroponte a long time ago. I have a question concerning the research effort that Huawei expects to do in the future, especially now in terms of the Sputnik moment that Professor Negroponte mentioned, and whether how is Huawei going to address the issue about basic research, which you mentioned also is an important ingredient for the future knowledge, creation of knowledge, and also the issue with the creativity difficulties that the educational system have in China to support this basic research effort.
Mr. Ren?
Yeah.
Okay, Mr. Ren.
我认为呢，就是我们永远都愿意给所有的科学家、大学加强合作的，对吧？我们在给大学合作呢，使用的是美国的拜杜法案，就是我们对大学的教授给予投资，但是我们不占有任何成果，对吧？这些成果就是归学校、归教授他们的，也不在论文的最后再注一个名字，也不要，对吧？所以我们认为呢，就是即使哪个办职、哪个学校暂时不合作，并不要紧，因为人类社会的学校还很多，大家也应该知道，五 G 比整个世界看得这么严重，甚至当成给原子弹一样的看重，其实就是土耳其一个教授一篇论文引发的。对吧？大家也没想到，这也不是 MIT 的论文，对吧？这是土耳其教授的一篇论文，发表不过是 MIT 学生。是 MIT 的
香农
的学生，对吧？所以因此呢，我们认为人类社会很广泛，大学非常多，我们哪个地方天涯何处无芳草，哪个地方都有优秀的人物可以合作的，对吧？所以因此呢，我们认为我们不会为一时的挫折而放弃我们前进的努力。
好 ，more questions coming from there。Make sure you raise your hands during the answer session so I can see who you are. Please, over there. Yes.
Thank you. I'd like to ask a bit about China and innovation. How dependent is China's innovation system on its integration into the global innovation networks that have developed over the last few decades? And will China still be able to produce cutting-edge innovation if trans-border collaboration is substantially reduced? And that's a question for Mr. Ren.
Also for Mr. Ren.
Yeah.
You want to keep the other gentleman relaxed?
I'd like to hear their views if they'd like to share their views too.
Okay, Mr. Ren, 还是请您来回答。
我认为中国现在的这个创新啊，虽然大家看起来蓬蓬勃勃，对吧？大多数是应用创新。是在世界这个平台的基础上在创新。如果离开世界这个平台，我认为我们的创新是会有很大挫折的，因为中国在基础理论的投入和基础教育上的问题上，还需要一个努力，这个需要一个努力才能实现。所以刚才你提的问题，我就希望我们中国的各个及政府部门要注意这个问题。
Okay, anyone want to add up to that?
I just think that China is doing all sorts of innovation and basic research. You know, collaboration with a professor in Austria called Zeilinger with Professor Pan, I think, or is leading a Chinese innovator in cryptographic research, the first use of quantum entanglement transmitting messages absolutely securely across distances over satellite technology. I mean, there are just all these areas where Chinese are performing both basic research and applied research in many different ways. So I think this, all these beliefs about some failure of innovation in China are out of date. There are people talking about what it was like 20 years ago, and I just don't think that's the situation today in China.
And today, of course, we heard the great news coming from Professor Tu Youyou's team. There are new developments in her area. Of course, she's a Nobel Prize winner. Let's go to a question over there, and then we have one more on the second line, and then we have two questions from there, okay? So quickly.
那个任总你好，我是中国国际电视台 CGTN 记者葛云飞，我想问您一个关于知识产权的问题。我们知道现在很多美国媒体都在说，华为在创业的初期，盗窃了很多西方公司的商业机密和知识产权，对此您有个回应。然后就是说，现在华为手里现在有大概5万多个 5G 的专利，您是否觉得会把它武器化？谢谢。地点呢？华为从一开始呢就是很规范的。
尽管我们是一个小公司的时候，其实我们是有盗贼操守的。如果我们没有盗贼操守，我们走不到今天，对吧？我们和美国虽然发生了几起知识产权的官司，我们要相信美国法庭的判决，对吧？美国法庭的判决应该是公正的，基本是公平的。 所以这些东西，所以我们盗取知识产权呢，这是根本不可能的。第二个，我们拥有很多知识产权，我们会不会把武器化是不会的。但是知识产权是因为通过劳动创造出来的，所以因此相互之间的交叉许可和相互付钱。 是比是可是比是的，所以世界有非常大公司，每年都给华为付出很多的这个专利费，因为我们都有保密协议，说我们不能告诉哪个公司付了多少钱，对吧？但是我们不会把它作为武器化来抑制人类社会的发展，对吧？我们呢，之所以这些年。 没有像很多公司去索要钱呢，是我们还忙不过来，我们发展太快了，对吧？当我们忙不过，等我们不忙的时候，我们有余量的、有闲下来的时间，我们就给人家要的钱，可能要的也不一定多，对吧？不一定像高中那么多，那我们可能少要一点吧。现在忙不忙啊，林先生？现在还是很忙的。
好，we have one more. Let me just collect the
这个起了好多次手了。他说有很多次手。Let
me collect the question. 我现在把咱们大家的问题集中一下 ，because we only have 8 minutes left. Why don't we collect all these questions and then we let our panelists to answer them together? Is that okay? Is that fair? Okay. 好，我们 okay. So you don't want to ask question. You want to refer to that lady. Okay. 来给她一个话筒。好。 Very quickly, please say who you are and your question, please.
Sure, I'm a reporter with the Washington Post.
If you want to stand up so that they
yeah,
could
sorry,
see you
sorry, I
really.
Just have a computer on my lap.
Thank you, ma'am. Because you're behind the camera.
I'm a reporter with the Washington Post. A question for Mr. Ren. There was a report today that Huawei is expecting a 40 to 60% drop in its international cell phone sales. I just wanted to confirm whether that's true. And can you also clarify the status of U.S. suppliers? Are most of your U.S. suppliers not supplying you at this point, or are they continuing to because of the 90-day reprieve, or what's the status?
手机怎么样卖的？第二个是我们美国的合作公司还给不给我们相关的这个原机电啊？好，来，我们再问几个问题。This lady in the middle, you've been raising your hands. Who you are? Question.
Thank you very much. My name is Charisse Pham. I'm with CNN. Question for the whole panel. I'll start it off with Mr. Ren. You talked about the internet generation and how ideology has not been diluted, and the future is going to be brighter and not darker. And you also talked about using Google Maps to look at how fish is farmed around the world. Very interesting. I am curious about your views on China's vast censorship apparatus, which has blocked Google's search and map functions in your country, and other US and foreign tech. Can the future still be as bright as you envision when you have a whole generation that has been sort of walled off for them that kind of information? And some people in China pointed out that, you know, this walling off was sort of inviting back retaliation eventually. So your thoughts on that. And for the rest of the panel, too, just related to that question, Mr. Gilder and Negroponte, you've talked a lot about advocating the U.S. to be more open to collaboration. Should China also be more open to relaxing its censorship and moving away from what they call a sovereign internet policy?
Okay, thank open you. Or not, countries around the world. Let's go to other questions. Yes, please, this gentleman, 这边这位男士, 哎, 咱们把问题都一起问了，然后我们再统一回答，这样快些。我是来自暨南大学的陈金地，我想问任总一个问题啊。
就我们知道，华为不仅是这个一家中国企业，更是一家全球企业，因为在170多个国家都有这个业务和分支。那么，如何刚才这个 MIT 的 Negroponte 提到他的这个 lab 有 60% 的是来自于其他国家的这个？那么华为有多少比例？然后你们怎么样以后吸取更多的全球的这个人才？谢谢。
Talents around the world. Thank you. Next one, that gentleman, 这位。
我是来自中国国家高端智库，就是中国综合开发研究院的。我想请教各位，就是在当前，大家刚刚都提到哈，合作是很重要的哈，但是在当前在政治或各种原因下，在产业链合作上中断的情况下，我们华为包括这种科技公司，是不是可以能否存在一种可能，就是通过国际的科技巨头的合作，比如国际科技论坛呢，或者国际科技联盟的方式，探索第三条道路，促进人类的科技发展的问题。
谢谢。I don't know which third road you're talking about. Certainly, way of cooperating, right? If there is some difficulties. Okay, I think we're running out. We have everyone almost wants to ask a question right here, but we have 3 minutes left. So let's go through this very quickly. 咱们就剩三分钟的时间啊，咱们来说一下手机是不是会大量 下降销售量，然后与此同时，是不是也希望是有一个更加开放的空间？怎么来进行国际的合作？Mr.
Ren，刚才华盛顿邮报的记者的提问呢，就是我们在国际上手机是不是下降了40%？是的，是下降了40%，对吧？但是我们在中国市场上的手机的增长速度呢，也很快，对吧？也很快，这是第一点。 第二点呢，就是开放合作作为华公司所主导的呢，永远不会改变。但是是政府主导呢，是政府之间的谈判问题，对吧？谈是政府之间的谈判问题，因为就是对吧？这是这个第二个问题。第三个有没有第三条道路？我说我们没想过第三条道路，对不对？我们就想就是一条路，我们就是一根筋。 慢慢的往上爬，一旦爬不动了，就像爬那个雪山一样，爬不动了，哗，滑下来一下，我们继续往上爬，我们终有一天是能爬到山顶的。还有一个关于全球人才问题，全球人才问题呢，应该在我们拥有的人才应该在170个国家都拥有，对不对？大概有3万多名这个到10万名左右的外籍员工。 但是到底哪个国家有多少，怎么数量我算不出来，对吧？算不出来。所以人才的问题呢，就是我们大概是这么一个状况，对吧？OK,
Mr. Gilder, openness, global talents, cooperation, keywords.
I think there's been a lot of talk about the Internet of Things, but what's really critical now is to create an Internet of Facts, an Internet of Trust, an Internet of Transactions. And my life after Google is about how trust can be recreated by new technical solutions through blockchains and cryptography and other advances that luckily the whole new generation of technologists are now pioneering. So many of these political problems tend to dissolve when new technical solutions are presented. And I think Huawei can contribute vitally to the Internet of Trust, which at the same time will make it possible for Huawei to sell its products in the United States again.
Mr. Negroponte.
Well, I will focus on the CNN question because there's something that's happened in the past couple of years which has led up to the recent events, which frankly is an anti-Chinese sentiment that has been created in the United States, and it's gotten worse and worse and worse. And part of the blame goes, if I may say, to your current president, who's disappointed us. We expected China to liberalize and continue, and we saw a path, and that changed suddenly. And that is disappointing. And we do have to get rid of the tariffs, we have to do all the things that George and I would love to see happen, but China does have to change. You can't continue, you know, fencing off the internet. And, you know, I arrived in this hotel, or at least the hotel down the street, and many of my apps didn't work, and I couldn't do things on Google, and it was infuriating, truly infuriating. And it was a reminder that I was okay. Here, and it was a very sad reminder. So that has to be changed. But I'm still going to advocate open research. Always, just it has to be open. And if it's not 100% symmetrical in the beginning, it will be. Mm.
You've been talking about open science and global connectivity. So we have 1 minute left, 1 minute only, ladies and gentlemen on the stage. 我们只有一分钟的时间, everybody, one sentence only, the biggest takeaway with a coffee with Ren today. 最大今天喝了咖啡之后的收获是什么呀? 我们请 Ms. Chen, you go first. One sentence, 一句话吧。
三句吧。
Allow me to have three sentences.
刚讲华为是不会 有任何的后门，而且我们的产品是要开放的，是要透明的，是要安全可信的。但是后面比较重要，华为的前门永远打开，然后包括通过媒体的平台，让大家来看、来了解。谢谢您。
Thank you, Mr. Gilder. One sentence or three short sentences, as Ms. Chen just did.
I think this Huawei is at the epicenter of the future of technology in the world, with how the United States and other countries react to this campaign against Huawei is kind of a Huawei test for people around the world. And if they don't pass it, it will signify that the world is taking a very destructive turn, anathematizing particular companies in the name of vague ideological objections. And so it's the Huawei test, and I hope the world meets it.
It's an interesting and important case study, I guess.
Yeah.
Mm. Mr. Negroponte.
Yeah, I guess I would end by saying, in going through that test, I would not focus on security and backdoors and whether you're going to interact with the Chinese government if they could. But leave that out. And I think you should focus on the 100,000 papers you publish, the amount of research, and just make it known. Because I feel I'm a lone voice. I'm at a dinner party and I say, Huawei's a great company. And people say it is. It does. And then the world has to know how much you're doing in science and technology.
Well, I guess the media need to know too, in a way. Now our colleagues are sitting here, they all got informed, at least through this, a little bit. Yeah. Mr. Ren, it's a coffee with Ren, so you have to speak first. 最后,您说句话。
我觉得这个世界就是合作共赢。
I think the world's student has to go through open cooperation. That would be my one last sentence.
简单,
open cooperation.
也不简单.
Well, that's simple.
Thank
and
you
not simple.
So much, the four of you.
He gets an A+ as my student.
Right. He did. He did. For the very first time.
谢谢。你看，我比乔布斯成绩好一点了。好，不错，这次考试都很好。<laughs>
And with that, we're wrapping up today's first, a coffee with Ren. We hope there will be many coffees to come. in the future in which we can talk and interact and certainly be intellectually stimulating for one another. So thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen on the stage. 谢谢. And our great audience and colleagues. 谢谢，我们拍一张照片吧，好不好？ Let's take a photo together. We love photos.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of today's panel, and I would like to thank our panelists for flying all this way to their thoughts and insight. I also want to thank our audience for coming together and spend the time and join us.Okay, so I hope that in the very soon in the future, we can welcome you again at Huawei, and you can come again to have a cup of coffee with Mr. Ren. Okay, thank you, and goodbye.